welcome everybody to the Dynasty Hot Sauce Podcast. I'm Larry Monkey, as always, and I'm here again and again and again. The long ass Mississippi hippie, Mr. Justin Rogers. What's up, my man?
Man, not a whole lot. Knocked out the run in the rain. It was nice. Just enough drizzle to keep things cool because it's one bazillion degrees down here. Oh, now I'm popping beers and ready to talk some football.
We're covering like the whole geographical map of the country right now. I mean, well, there's only three of us tonight, but as far as like East Coast, West Coast, and you're down in the South there.
Yes, I am down in the South. But, you know, you're going to talk about our guest before you even intro the guy? Goodness. What is wrong with you? All these things we've got to talk about. All the buzzworthy news.
Oh, I see what you did there.
And you're just going to leave our guest back there waiting to come in. We're going to talk about where he's from. Talk about his kids, his social security number, and favorite passwords. But not the actual guest. Come on, Larry. What the hell?
All right. Should I bring this guy in?
I reckon you probably should, you asshole.
Oh, let's do this. Oh, baby. Are you ready? Oh, we got the VP of Ops at the Fantasy Alarm. He's an award-winning host for SiriusXM. He's got a show every day in a week almost. The Annie Up Podcast. He writes for the New York Post. At Roto Buzz Guy on Twitter, Mr. Howard. Ah, what's up, my man?
And the crowd goes wild. What's going on, guys? Thanks so much for having me, man. It's Larry. I feel like we just hung out this a few days ago. Justin, great to see you, man. Thanks so much for inviting me, man. It's a definite pleasure.
Yeah, we're becoming fast friends, it seems. Just recently did a DLF team series with Calvin and Hobby, and we talked Jets, man, which was great because it was a nice follow-up to our first meeting when it was like right after the season, and we started, and it was like some Jets preview. So, yeah, man.
So you guys have done like two podcasts together, and well, you've spoken for like, what, 8-9 minutes total?
There's
not much to say about the Jets, right?
Good things brewing in New York. Okay, that's it. What else we got?
All right. So good to talk to you. And folks, catch us next week.
You have this new YouTube show on that Catching Fire right now. Had some pretty good guests on the past few weeks. What's going on with that? Get buzzed, getting buzzed.
Yeah, it's called Getting Buzzed. I'm on there. My co-host is Ryan Hallam. You can find him on Twitter at Fighting Chance. And yeah, listen, it's like a talk show more than it is like a fantasy sports. Like we touch on a bunch of sports things that are going on in the news, and you know we'll talk about the Aaron Rodgers drama or the Deshaun Watson situation. We'll hit that early, but. You know, one of the things that I've always felt is that you need to know who your analysts are. Like, you know, we're just, you know, names on Twitter, handles on Twitter. And, you know, you always like to know who you're putting your faith in, who you're putting your trust in, and what kind of work they do. So, you know, I bring people on. It's, you know, it's more about getting to know these analysts in the fantasy space as much as it is about, you know, talking football. So, you know, yeah, we've had some great guests coming on so far. Tara Roberts from the Dynasty Vipers, Jen Piacenti from Fantasy Alarm, obviously. Faith Enos from IDP Guys. We've run through a bunch. Scott Fish was on the show, so yeah, right. we've hit the ground running with that. It's a lot of fun. Just you know, kind of a looser atmosphere than what I'm used to, you know, doing like SiriusXM or, you know, something like that. So it just gives me a chance to have a little fun.
Nice, man. Well, you came to the right place tonight. I'll tell you that. Wouldn't you say so, Justin?
You know, if we're just going to bullshit around and just ramble on, and this is what you like, then we're your spot.
So check this out. So Faith is actually, she's hosting a best ball tournament that I was a part of last year called the Hot Sauce. It was a hot sauce coming in hot best ball. It was a live YouTube show, and she was kind of like the MC, and we all had our sauces, and Stoner was there, and Bo McBigtime and Chase Vernon. And anyway, we had, it was like, you know, it was 12 of us, this live draft, and they'd spin this wheel of death, and you'd have to, every few rounds, you'd have to escalate to a higher Scoville unit of sauce. And it was really amazing. And I mean, obviously it was a terrible following day. It was a fun time during that night. But anyway, she's hosting it again. The Dynasty Hot Sauce Pod is kind of taking control over it this year. We're going to have some folks from last year as well. And
roll a toilet paper in the freezer on time.
Somebody on Reddit was like, you just stick a popsicle by the bathroom so you're ready for the next day. You know, that may be it.
Yeah,
I'm telling you guys, it all works like a charm. Go to get like the Cottonelle that has like the aloe in it.
Uh-huh.
Right? Because it's a thicker ply. You stick that, roll of that into the freezer.
Okay.
Like, well, heaven, baby. It's a game changer.
The tip of the night, folks.
It is a life changing thing. I'm telling you.
Cottonelle and Angel in the freezer.
Right. So right now we still haven't filled out the league, but right now we have Kyle on the couch, FF. At Dogleg Brewer, Chase Vernon, the fantasy girl, Rosalie Michaels, Faith, Bo McBigtime, Justin, and Nate Polvo, our buddy at FF Chin Sword. I'm just going to say that's not his Twitter handle, but
that should totally be his Twitter handle by now. What the hell? we got into that one.
Yeah. I'm not saying his Twitter handle, it's too confusing. Just FF Chin Sword is fine. But yeah, man, the Scott Fish Bowl, baby. You're in the fish division. Is this correct?
That is correct. Absolutely. That's the background that you see here is probably one of the last fish shows I attended before the pandemic.
Really? Nice, dude. I have seen fish. I'm an old timer like you. Now, you know, we're not super old, but we're, you know, we've both seen fish probably in 1991, right?
That is 100% accurate. Yes.
So, yeah. So we're fish 1991 old, but yeah, man, saw them. I've seen fish a couple of times, but were they your first love, or did you evolve into fish?
I evolved into fish. I mean, my musical journey, so to speak, was, my dad was into like all of like the folk music, you know, Joan Baez, Buffy St. Marie, like, you know, the 60s and 70s folk stuff. My mom was into Barry Manilow, the Carpenters, and like John Denver. So that's what I grew up listening to, which immediately turned me into heavy metal. So Iron Maiden, Black Sabbath, the Scorpions, like those were the bands that I listened to when I was younger. And then I drifted into classic rock, discovered the Dead. And I mean, like just went to my first Dead show in 87, Nassau Coliseum in New York. First Dead show there, stayed a Deadhead, and then just saw Fish for the first time when I was in college in 1989. And then proceeded to see, you know, just kind of follow them around a little bit. You know, during breaks, go to, you know, wherever they were around, or they were, you know, a lot of times playing in like New York City at the Wetlands. So, you know, it was kind of that. And then when Jerry passed away and I had no other group to follow around, I ended up on Fish Tour on a regular basis.
Are you from Long Island? Is that where you're?
I grew up in New York City, high school out on Long Island, junior high school out on Long Island. And then 4 years of college upstate New York.
My wife's from Long Island, actually.
Well, there you go. Maybe she and I know each other. I'll look her up in the Long Island directory.
The LISC. Are you familiar with the LISC?
No, I'm not, actually.
Well, he has deleted some names, or he's crossed off a few names on that directory. He's the Long Island serial killer. And if you you want to know anything about
it? Otherwise known as Sal,
aka Salito.
Salito.
Oh shit!
Anyway, man, that's cool, bro. Yeah, I've seen the Dead too a couple of times, or a few times actually. And then, our paths may have crossed, dude. You tended bar in the city. When did you get out of New York, anyway?
Jeez, I moved out of New York in 2007. So if you, you know what? I mean, in New York from 1990, 97 through like 2007, that 10-year span among the different Heartland breweries around New York.
Oh, so, yeah.
Union Square, Midtown on 51st and 6th, the one in the Seaport for a little while, the one in the Empire State Building. I worked them all, basically. Yeah,
I'm sure our paths have crossed. I lived in Queens for a few years. Fantasy football, dude. So, wait, you're this kid in New York City that got into fish. How do you get into fantasy football? Like, how old were you, part of your life?
It was like high school, I guess, is when I first got into fantasy baseball. You know, a friend of mine's dad got, you know, he had a league going. So, you know, we jumped in on that. Always just a huge diehard baseball fan, you know, to begin with. You know, it was like, you know, when we were in Manhattan, you know, it was so close to Yankee Stadium as a kid. And it was different back then, right? Like you and three or four of your friends could like hop the subway on a Friday and shoot up to Yankee Stadium and, you know, go get like bleacher seats. You know, it was like the late 70s, early 80s at that point. You know, your parents were like, yeah, sure, go ahead. It was totally cool with that, you know, for that. But, you know, I guess, so it was fantasy baseball first, then that drifted over to fantasy football where, you know, we were like, well, we might as well be doing this. And it was all keeping score by hand. And
You're one of those guys, huh?
Yeah, I was one of those guys.
You can't start back then and not be one of those guys.
Right? Yeah, exactly. Well,
I mean, what are you talking, like late 80s, early 90s?
It was late 80s was where it was. Yeah, like mid to late 80s is probably where it all kind of started.
Right.
I took a break from it for a while and wasn't playing fantasy sports, you know, when, you know, I was in college and then, you know, out of college and working in New York City and stuff. So that kind of, you know, I took some time off from that, but I got involved in a rotating poker game every Sunday night. There were like seven or eight of us. And one day one of the guys was like, we should totally start a fantasy baseball league. And I was like, dude, done. Absolutely. no doubt. Right. Okay. Sitting there, you know, cause we're playing cards, right. And the deal's going this way and the bong's being passed this way and the trade talk's going around the table there. So it was a natural progression for us. And that's, you know, like right about then the internet blew up the fantasy sports industry.
Yeah.
You know, really big. There are all these platforms developing for playing, you know, playing in your leagues. And then I guess it was probably like right around 99 or 2000 when I was like reading stuff and thinking, man, I could do this. I've won leagues. I feel good about my knowledge here. I'm a capable writer. So I'm college educated. So
I figured out the internet already.
So I started a blog on blogspot.com back in the day
and
just wrote every single day and then just started sending my links out to, you know, every time you grab a magazine, you find out who the managing editor is and just emailing them and sending them my stuff until it all just kind of snowballed.
That's a slick move, man. Digging into the guy's name at the bottom of the article or whatever, and then you're just reaching out to him. Nice, man. It's aggressive.
Gotta
it's the only way
it.
To get somewhere, man.
You gotta hustle.
That's hustling, man.
It's hustling for back in the day.
Yeah.
So what is your fantasy, man? Are you the Devy guy, the redraft guy, Dynasty, DFS, Keeper League? Like what's your go-to? What do you prefer? Football, baseball?
I mean, I love them both. I don't mind. I can't say whether or not I really have a genuine preference because I like the grind of fantasy baseball. And that just kind of shows, you know, who's made out of it and who's not, you know, and like you see who quits on leagues and stuff like that. So, you know, baseball was always my first love because I grew up, you know, playing stickball and, you know, emulating those, you know, those late 70s Yankees and Chris Chambliss and I have the same birthday. It was like exciting stuff. Munson was my favorite player of all time.
Oscar Gamble, right?
Oscar Gamble with the big fro and the weird ass stance. So that was definitely my first love. And then obviously, you know, being a Jets fan and not seeing any Super Bowls in my lifetime. You know, that's, you know, it always kind of hurts a little bit. But, you know, with the fantasy game, I love them both. I don't have any kind of a major preference. I like a good keeper league where in, like, baseball you're keeping, like, you know, maybe five guys on your roster, six guys on your roster. Football, you're keeping maybe, like, three or four. I'm okay with that. I don't, you know, it's kind of funny. I've moved away from the dynasty leagues a little bit more because I still see so much turnover and in dynasty leagues. And really it's like, what are you doing in a dynasty league that, you know, like, why are you joining a dynasty league if you're only going to be there for like 2 or 3 years?
That's important.
You know? I feel you on that.
Got to get a good league. Got to get a good league, man.
It's important. And it's tough to have because, I mean, listen, obviously everybody's gung-ho when it first starts, but then life happens and, you know, all of a sudden it's like, oh, I can't make the draft. I got my baby cousin's niece's christening I got to go to and stuff like that.
Hey, I have a question. When you're doing – so I've played baseball, fantasy baseball, for the last 25 years and most of that time two leagues at a time. And then this was the first year I did not have any fantasy baseball. I mean, last year we didn't do it because of the COVID. And this year I was just like, you know, I'm all in on football. I actually have won the league the last 2 years. It was a daily changes, but you could only make like 80 moves throughout the whole season.
Okay.
And so the trick is back into the playoffs with all your moves. And then you're just throwing pitchers at everybody and hitters and you're filling your lineup and you have, you know, so you're really just outscoring based on volume. I figured that out before everyone else did, I guess. But I find, and then towards the end, the fantasy playoffs roll right into the beginning of the football season. So there's like double duty going on right there too. So I can remember being exhausted after just like, you know, the stress of being in a championship for baseball and then, you know, you're dealing with your lineups for football, which are kind of secondary right now because you're in this title matchup in baseball. Have you felt, you know what I'm talking about? Am I making any sense right now?
No, you're definitely making sense. September is a huge pain in the ass. August is too, because, you know, you're dealing with draft season for football and you're focusing on that. But, you know, all of a sudden you've got the trade deadline for MLB was on, you know, the last day of July. So then you're spending August trying to figure out, okay, which team sold off players? Now I got to start looking at who they're bringing up. And so August and September, and then September, the rosters expand. So there's like a whole new group of players into it. And all that while, you're like, damn, I got to set my week one line up here.
Right.
I got to do it on the mock draft.
Comes right after Labor Day. So
in baseball, there are hot waiver pickups at the end of the season. It's not like football where it's just kind of like scraps pretty much after the first few weeks. Baseball, there's like some hot guys that aren't even in the system yet that pop up on waivers. So it's like,
but I mean, what am I gonna complain that this is my job? No.
What a terrible life.
Woe is me. The overlap in September is just too much.
My fish concert, my live concert background, and
well, see, and that's the other thing, right? I got fish playing in Tahoe and then Colorado over Labor Day weekend. I got to hit those shows. So, I mean, yeah, this is – I'm all twisted up, man. It's a terrible time for me, guys. Just so terrible.
How'd you hook up with the Post? Same thing? The guy was tired of hearing from you. It was like, all right, man, come on in for – let's go.
No, they approached me. You know, the Post had – they had a working deal with – back in the day it was Roto Experts. And guys like Scott Engel and Adam Ronis, they were the guys there. Well, I guess Roto Experts, you know, they went under, and the Post came to us, and they were like, you know, hey, would you be interested in, you know, writing a column? Which was really funny because born and raised New York and been there my whole life, right? And then it took me moving out to San Francisco and being out here for about 2 or 3 years. And then all of a sudden now the New York Post comes calling. I was like, okay.
Right.
Took me, you know, 10 years to be away from everything before the post started calling my name.
Let's start talking about some guys here, man. I hear that you're in on the Chargers offense. I mean, who's not in on the Chargers offense? But Mike Williams in particular. Think he's a good grab right now in drafts. I mean, we're doing it. I mean, I guess we should talk about redraft season to a certain extent, since that's what's all everybody's gearing up for, and all the charity leagues are popping off right now.
So, you know, I mean, the whole thing, and, you know, and I deal with this on Fantasy Alarm all the time, because I just finished writing a series where I broke down every coaching system, offense and defense for every team, you know, which players fit best, which ones don't. You know, you track the coaching movement, because, you know, I think a lot of people who cover fantasy sports do it in kind of a surface fashion, where they're just like, okay, you know, they're living off of hot takes, and, you know, oh, this guy should be good. But, you know, it's like I dive in deep to the point where it's like, okay, Joe Lombardi, quarterback coach for the Saints the last 10 years, he's now going over to the Chargers, and he's bringing that Saints offensive scheme to L.A. And because the personnel fits really well there, right? Austin Eckler in that Alvin Kamara role, Justin Herbert, you know, he can work the short timing routes, the short passes in the West Coast offense. Plus, he's got the great gun to go deep. You know, it's interesting to see how it's going to unfold, because Keenan Allen is definitely the safety net for Justin Herbert.
He's like a better version of Michael Thomas. So
right, but the thing is that Michael Thomas was the X receiver in that offensive scheme. Keenan Allen does the majority of his work out of the slot. You know, Mike Williams is the X receiver for the Chargers. So I'm not saying that Mike Williams is going to suddenly get Michael Thomas-like work. It'll still go. You'll still see a lot to Keenan Allen. But I definitely see an increase in targets for Mike Williams, and because just based on the way that this scheme, you know, develops. And so you don't even have to move Mike Williams up on your board either. Like, that's the best part, is that people
have been super duper cheap. Yeah.
Well, people have been so disappointed, right? It was like, oh, he had, you know, 1,000 yards, but like 4 touchdowns. Or he had, you know, 800 yards, but he had 12 touchdowns. You know, so it's like that whole thing there. I think this is where Mike Williams finds his balance. And I think he definitely, I think this is like a, this is like a 1,000-yard season with, I would say, you know, probably in the 8 touchdown range, which, I mean, where you're taking him in drafts right now, I mean, where's he going in drafts? Like 9th round, 10th round? You know, people forget about him. So, yeah, I definitely dig that.
Mike Williams, baby. I think I'm in on Mike Williams.
I found myself grabbing him as a throw-in, because it feels like a throw-in.
Yeah.
He's got a lot going for him. He's got the old contract year going.
And when you do these drafts, these, like, you know, the best ball drafts that have like the overall, like the Scott Fish Bowl or the Raz Bowl, which just started up this week, you know, I like stacking in those tournament leagues. So, you know, for the price that it costs you, you know, Keenan Allen in the 3rd round, Justin Herbert in the 6th round, Mike Williams in the 9th round, like all of a sudden that's a great little stack. And if you miss on any of the, you know, on one of the receivers, then you grab Jared Cook, who spent the last 2 seasons with the Saints, working with Joe Lombardi, working in this system. And over 2 years, he averaged like 700 yards and you know, like 7 touchdowns, something like that. Yeah. It's not bad for a tight end. That doesn't cost you anything.
Right, it's dirt ass cheap.
We talked about Michael Thomas just now.
Yeah. My goodness. We just found out he's going to miss it like the first 4, 5, 6 games of the year.
I mean, I was kind of out on Michael Thomas anyway. Just
it's too knee-jerk reaction to just bail on Michael Thomas, in my opinion. But there is, I mean, when you lose half of a season of, you know, regular season fantasy production at age 28, I mean, that's something to consider. There's no doubt about that.
Would you give up a 2022 first round pick for Michael Thomas?
No.
Can I do it in October? Probably. Yeah. About the time he's going to be ready to play. Yeah. And I know he's going to be on the field. I don't want to do it now and then him end up missing 8, 9, 10 games. Well, you know,
they said week 8, worst case scenario.
Worst case. But again, we don't know.
Yeah. Is that really worst case scenario? Right. Or is, like, or is having a setback and during rehab and you're exactly. missing the whole season. That's right. worst case scenario. Yeah.
I don't want to do it now because I think I can do it later in the season.
Right.
When he's or I miss out on that one league and I go to another league and buy him.
And if the Saints end up being a dumpster fire, then.
Right. Yeah. If Taysom Hill is starting and they're throwing for 140 yards a game, I don't want to buy him anyway. Shit.
I don't know. But I still want Darnold instead of Michael Thomas.
Yeah. That was a topic that came up in the chat today. So
I'm okay with that. I'll draft Sam Darnold before I'll draft Michael Thomas.
Yes. In a super flex.
It's not even a super flex. I got to be honest with you. Like, Michael Thomas is, was a phenomenal receiver.
Yeah. Yes.
With a great quarterback.
He's going to miss time this year.
Absolutely.
So we don't know exactly how much time he's going to miss. Is it worth making that pick knowing that you're eating a bench spot for however long it is? For Michael Thomas to be Michael Thomas, I mean, he needs to come back. He needs to see all the targets again. He needs to be able to cut and run with no problem. He needs to be fully up to speed on whatever scheme that they're actually doing. There are a lot of things that need to happen. He needs to avoid all setbacks, right? So there's so many things that need to happen for Michael Thomas to return to Michael Thomas level that I would rather let that be somebody else's headache. Let them sit there. You know what? Yeah. Listen, if Thomas gets back to being normal Michael Thomas and you got him in the eighth round of your draft, mazel tov. Well done. You know, beautiful. I don't think that I need to endure that kind of headache and roster manipulation. I think I can win a league without dealing with that aggravation. So, for me, I'll bypass it completely.
Yeah, and see, for me, I don't think he's ever the 130, 140 catch, 14, 1,800, 1,700 yards, whatever. I don't think he's that. But I think he's the 80, 90 catch, 1,100-yard guy with 6-7 touchdowns. I'll take that over the quarterback that I'm not sure ever starts again after this year. And there's real question marks. And I don't care what anybody says. There's question marks about Sam Darnold.
Sure.
Okay. Everyone wants to say Tannehill. Everyone wants to reference Tannehill like he's going to be the next Tannehill. But how many quarterbacks have left a system and all of a sudden become great? And we also saw flashes of Tannehill being good. We haven't seen flashes of Darnold being good yet. But even under Adam Gase, Tannehill had some really nice moments. And I'm not sure that we saw that from Darnold. So
he also had a more of a supporting cast also.
He had Jarvis Landry and who? That's
great
it.
Guy.
Stop it. Stop it. That was embarrassing to say, wasn't it? That kind
of
hurt.
That's the only guy I could think of.
That's because there wasn't anybody else. I mean, I think Ted Ginn was on that team. I can't remember. I don't know. Like, it doesn't matter. Because literally there was Jarvis Landry and nobody else. So, I mean, I don't know. I want to see it before I believe it. So I'll take Michael Thomas because I know that in 2023, I'm still going to have some value there where I don't know that Sam Darnold is even in the league in 2023. And that sounds a little pessimistic, but I mean, there's real questions there. So I drafted Sam Darnold in an auction this year in a 16-team Superflex as my third quarterback. Like, sure, why not take a shot for dirt ass cheap? But I'm not paying any sort of premium for him.
No, but you don't have to pay it. That's the thing. You don't have to pay a premium for him. You can grab Sam Darnold in the 13th round, 14th round of your draft.
And yeah, but you're talking about but the discussion is Michael Thomas or Sam Darnold. And
well, how far? Right. I won't draft Michael Thomas in the 8th or 9th round. And that's where people are going to take him. Or that's where I think people start to look. I think they start to look at him in the 6th and 7th round and say,
How are we talking redraft or are we talking redraft or dynasty?
Redraft, yeah.
Oh, yeah, redraft, yeah. I'm not touching Michael Thomas in redraft. If someone wants to sit him on the back of the bench in redraft for 4 or 6 weeks, that's on them because they just got a wide receiver two sitting on their bench.
Right. All right. So you're in a keep. What if you're all right? So you're in a regular keeper league and somebody decides I'm not going to protect Michael Thomas because of his situation right now. And you're now drafting, you get to keep four guys on your roster. Which, and you still have like a 16-round draft that you got to do.
Yeah.
Where do you look for Michael Thomas there?
I don't want either of them in a redraft.
I'm saying in a keeper league.
even in a keeper, I mean, unless there's some sort of like, I'm going to keep him in the 15th round, because I mean, if it's like, okay, you lose your first four picks, or, you know, like I played in a couple keeper leagues, and one of them was auction, and it was previous year. And if you kept him a second time, it was $5 boost, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. The other one was your first, if you kept one player, it was your first round pick. You kept another player, it was your second round pick, third and fourth. And you had an option to keep four. You didn't have to keep anybody. You could keep any number of players, but every one of them counted as your first, second, third, or fourth round pick. And I was fine with that, because then it kind of gave some strategy. And I would break out a spreadsheet with ADP and start to like map it out. And I would always be the very last person putting in mine, because I wanted to know, if I didn't keep this person, what are the odds I get someone better than that? You know? So I don't know that Michael Thomas even makes a redraft team of mine. Well, and even as a keeper.
The question is Michael Thomas or Sam Darnold?
In a dynasty league.
Right.
Either or. This is the deal. I mean,
well, it's got to be a dynasty league, because in a redraft, okay, well, we can talk about this. If I'm rostering either of them, even in a redraft, I want Michael Thomas, because I don't think I'm ever starting Sam Darnold. I can pick a Sam Darnold up off the waiver wire at any point in a one.
But the weapons that he has now, and the stability at the coaching position, and the culture in general, and the weapons around him, supporting cast, the ceiling for him right now, I don't think there is a ceiling. I mean, I threw out there 150 points by the time Thomas returns.
Okay, so week 10.
Well, just say week 8.
Okay, so you're talking about 19 points a game.
QB12, that's Jared Goff last year numbers. After eight games in the season, 8 weeks,
listen, Larry, 8 weeks at 150 points is 18.75 points a game.
Dude, how many times is he going to dump off the CMC? Boom. Instant 40 yards right there.
Listen, I think the culture there in Carolina is very nice, and I like the way things are set up for Sam Darnold. I'm very bullish on the Carolina offense in general. I'm into that. And I do think that Sam Darnold is being set up to succeed right now, as opposed to what was going on with the Jets. And you know, like, just like you say, you need to see it from Sam Darnold before you invest. And I totally get that. I'm going to be on Larry's side here and advance through that and hope that that is the case. If my breakdown and my analysis of Joe Brady's and, you know, offensive scheme is right, then, you know, it is kind of tailored for Sam Darnold to have that eventual breakout year. But I can't sit here and look at these last two seasons with the Jets. You know, he has mono in his rookie year, and he misses a bunch of time there, and he's got to come back, and then, you know, just dealing with Gase and the play calling and the lack of a scheme and all the other nonsense.
Changes. He started his career with Todd Bowles.
If you were to look at, and I always still talking 16 game seasons, just because we haven't seen 17, we don't have a point of reference for that. If you were to look at it from a 16-game perspective, and he threw for 4,000 yards, 25 touchdowns, 12 interceptions, would that be what you expect?
First couple of seasons, sure.
Yeah, I mean, I'd be okay with that. I feel like, you know, I would like to see the touchdown count a little higher than 25.
The Jets haven't had a 4,000-yard passer since, like, 1960-something.
We're talking about him with Carolina now, not
with the Jets.
Exactly, yeah, but... Yeah.
We're talking about him with Carolina, but okay, let me ask you.
Okay.
Is that basically a ceiling, 4,000, 25, and 12?
No, I don't think that's the ceiling.
Really?
No way.
Really? You think he's throwing for more than 25 touchdowns?
I think he can, yes.
With protection and legit receivers and a all-pro running back?
But see, here's the thing. Quarterbacks lift their supporting cast. Supporting casts don't lift quarterbacks. I keep saying that because I believe it. You don't see... Oh, let's bring in a bunch of receivers and make an average quarterback good. Bring in a great quarterback and make average players good. Good players don't make a good fantasy quarterback. A good fantasy quarterback makes good players.
All right, because
you don't see a good quarter, like an average quarterback putting up great fantasy numbers. You just don't. It doesn't happen. Outside of a running quarterback.
I mean, listen, 4,000 yards and just, you know, if you, I mean, 25 touchdowns, that puts him right there in the in like, you know.
That would put him at 19 points a game is where I came at that.
Yeah. I'm looking at stats right there. That puts him where Matthew Stafford is right now.
Yeah.
You know, or in Matthew Stafford's year last year. Just over 4,000 yards, 26 touchdowns.
I think if that's Darnold's line this year, I think that's a successful season.
I think it's a successful year.
I think it's slam dunk success if he throws for 4,000.
Carolina will be doing cartwheels.
Yeah.
I feel like what I just threw out was his ceiling because I don't think he's a 30, 35 touchdown guy yet.
We don't know that. We haven't seen that.
I'm just telling you, we don't know anything about him. But clearly.
Would you have said, I mean, is Kirk Cousins a 35 touchdown guy?
Kirk Cousins played better than him from the jump.
Well, I'm just would you look at Kirk Cousins and be like, this is a 30 touchdown guy? Would you have looked at Tannehill and said, here's a 30 touchdown guy?
Well, Tannehill threw for 26, 27 with the Dolphins one time. And Kirk Cousins has been in the 27 to 30 something range.
Right. I get what you're saying there, but you're dismissing Darnold based on what happened for these 2 years with the Jets. And what you're saying that his ceiling.
I got a 3 year sample size though.
It was, well, I mean, not really though. I mean, if cumulatively, how many, what's the sample size? Minus all the BS, all the games he's missed. And he had a busted foot his first year, right? Was it his thumb or his toe or something?
He had the
You're dealing with a bunch of shit with him. You're definitely dealing with a bunch of shit with him. But, you know, cap him at 4,025.
Here's the thing. Even under Gase, here's the line that Tannehill put up in 2014. 4,045, 27 touchdowns, 12 interceptions, and he completed 66% of his passes.
Right.
I mean, and the next year he goes 42, 24, and 12. Like you saw something out of Tannehill before he left Gase. We didn't see anything from Darnold.
You've seen flashes. Everyone wants Darnold.
Really?
I mean, he's had a couple of moments, but I mean, he's not. There's nothing.
But he hasn't had even a half a season.
He's never had any consistency behind him.
No, but here's the thing. My point is, and let me just we'll wrap it up with everybody saying a little bit. But my point is that Darnold was not even Ryan Tannehill in Miami. Darnold was worse. Was half of Ryan Tannehill when he was with the New York Jets. Yeah. And so when you're talking about the Jets overall, were
significantly worse than the Dolphins.
Yeah, I'm just not sure that that's true. This is the Dolphins that won two games. No. You know, I mean, like this is the Dolphins that had the number one pick or a top five pick for several years. I mean, this is just it wasn't a good team. So I don't know.
Yeah, whatever.
But what I want to reiterate is that we saw something from Tannehill before he went to the Titans. We haven't seen anything from Darnold to suggest that he's going to take this significant leap and become a significant fantasy quarterback.
I'll be happy if Carolina beats the Jets. If Sam has a great game, he lights up the Jets.
Oh yeah,
that's going to happen. He's going to light the Jets.
5-3, right there on week one.
Right. I know. Everyone's going to.
There's been a nice dent in that fucking ceiling you got for him.
There are going to be some Sam Darnold victory laps come week one for sure.
Oh, that's my DFS quarterback week one, no doubt.
You know what? I'm on that train. I'm on it because it's the Jets. But then it's going to come crashing. Don't start him week two. I don't even care who he's playing, but don't start him week two.
No, he's actually has a great first eight games. That's the other part. We've talked enough about your lost love, Howard. And now I think it's time to talk about the new sheriff in town, Zach Wilson. Now, you kind of on the fence about this guy.
I'm going to need to hold on. I'm going to pop a beer open for this one. All right. Here we go.
What's it going to take for you to, for this guy to get back into your good graces?
Yeah, will you tell Jamarcus Russell 2.0 to get on his ass?
Come on. Trey Lance isn't even
tired. That's hurtful.
I know, but I put it on that just for a little bit.
My wife and I owned a live music venue here. We owned a club in San Francisco, and Jamarcus used to show up on a regular basis with his bloodshot eyes on a Saturday night, right? All glassy eyed and everything. And you were like, oh, all right, I'm betting against the Raiders this week.
Take, nice. yeah, I'll take, They can always, if they get an early pick next year, they can trade for Deshaun Watson.
Oh, get out of here. Now you're going to get Roto-Bud guy all hot and bothered again.
Shit's cold, right? For a hot sauce barbecue podcast, man, that was some cold shit right there.
Yes, Howard. Yeah, man, when we got together that first go-round on the Dynasty Viper show, the team series, before, that was right after the Super Bowl, I guess. It was maybe in March, perhaps, right before free agency really kicked off. We didn't really know
before much. Everyone knew that. That Deshaun Watson's a little creeper.
Well, yeah, you're right. Yeah, yeah.
That was probably a significant part of the conversation was that no one knew that he was going to have 22 women filing.
Yeah, no, we didn't know about.
At that point, everyone wanted Deshaun Watson. So,
yes, but I mean, in retrospect, are you glad that we didn't trade for him before all this nonsense?
Well, I mean, you know, obviously you don't want that. There's so many different layers to this whole thing with Deshaun Watson. I'm letting it all play out before I really, jump into it because, listen, the Texans organization is garbage.
Jets-like.
No, it's not even. No, it's not.
Even worse than the Jets.
Because yeah, it's so much worse than the Jets.
Like DeAndre Hopkins for David Johnson in a second. Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, that was the one.
You know?
Right, like and then turning around and saying that you made that deal because DeAndre Hopkins is a clubhouse cancer.
Right.
Right.
Like we didn't hear a thing about Deshaun Watson until he got pissed off that Jack Easterby was in charge of picking the GM and that Easterby was the one who was supposed to talk to Watson, was supposed to talk to other people, and didn't do it. And he brought in Casario, who was one of his boys when they were together. And, he was like the chaplain in New England or whatever it was. And then, and then all of a sudden, Watson demands a trade. And then that's when all of a sudden everything started.
Right.
Watson says he doesn't want to play for the Texans anymore. And then all of a sudden, 22 women suddenly miraculously came forward. Listen, if he's guilty, he's a total scumbag and he needs to be out of it. Yeah. And that's just it, right? But I'm not going to say that some of this shit that the Texans organization does isn't a little suspicious. Like, what if this whole thing, McNair, who is...
Then I'm going to celebrate because I bought a bunch of Deshaun.
Yeah, he's a Deshaun. He's got Deshaun everywhere.
For the cheap.
I'm just saying, yes, it's a conspiracy theory, but there hasn't been anything to disprove that right now. And if that, this is something that's so serious that, fucking Goodell should be all over this shit, right? And take that stance.
Goodell
you were crawling up the asses of Washington and Dan Snyder and everybody there for sexually harassing women in the workplace. Yep. If you've got a serial predator out there right now, why all of a sudden are you putting off a deposition till after the football season finishes? What is the deal there? Why is that the case?
Yeah, there's something weird about it. That's for sure.
Speaking of a disgruntled organization, the Green Bay Packers.
Look at this segue. That was some professional segue shit, Larry. It's the first time.
Aaron Rodgers rolls in today like nothing's everything's cool. You think he's going to just pick up where he left off? You taking him where you normally take him in a redraft league, Howard?
When a guy has that kind of a year like Aaron Rodgers put together last year, I'm going to let him. If he falls to like. The teens, then maybe I will, not going to bite on it early. I never, when a guy has a year like that, it's even like Josh Allen, right? I love Josh Allen, but that dude put a career year up last year. I need to see if there's going to be regression or if there's actually, is he on the upward trajectory? Is he going to plateau there? Is there going to be some pullback? I'm fine with kind of waiting and seeing because I don't like paying, it's like paying retail. I don't want to pay retail prices for a guy based off of what he did last year. I want to see something a little bit more, I can get by at more reasonably priced guys.
Speaking of reasonably priced guys, I don't know. Somebody's stock's going up lately after Rojo seemed to be able to hit the hole without hesitation, and everybody's going nuts about it. What's up? Have we seen the last of the hashtag never Rojo?
You know what? When Tom Brady weighs in on what he thinks of Ronald Jones, then I'll know whether or not you invest or you don't. Right? Because, I mean, you know, what Tommy wants, Tommy gets. And Tommy was obviously not happy with what they had there. Tell you, Gio Bernard is the sleeper in that stupid offense right now. Right? Playing that that James White role. Bless you.
I muted that, right?
You did.
Good job. Oh, okay. Good I was job. Panicking. I was like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
But, I mean, that's, you know, you look at that. I mean, I'm sorry. It's just, it's not. Brady is the one who asked for Gio Bernard. So I know Gio Bernard is a good pass blocker. I know he can catch passes. If Tommy wants to use him on third down, he will. Right. Let Rojo and Leonard Fournette kind of split up that early down work. I know that's it's not a backfield I'm investing in.
How you feel about that, Justin?
I've always liked Rojo, so I can't really say much. I mean, I think he's just a better running back right now than Leonard Fournette is. For his cost, sure, I'm in. You know, because you're getting him in the 10th, 11th round, whatever. I'm in, whatever. So I just think he's a better running back. Don't expect him in a PPR league to be a top 7, 8, 10 guy. That's not going to happen. But, I mean, when he had the rock and they were giving it to him and feeding him when Leonard Fournette was hurt, that dude was killing it. Yeah. I mean, breaking off big runs, consistently gaining yardage. I mean, I'm all about Rojo. So,
yeah, it was just the drop passes that Tom was like, nope, sorry, can't deal with that.
All right. But then Leonard Fournette wasn't that much better in the passing game.
He definitely was not, which is why they went out and got Gio Bernard, which is, you know, puts you at that 12th, 13th round sleeper pick.
I don't even know if you got to get – he might be their 16th round last pick of the draft.
Could be, like, could be.
Both of my home leagues, I don't require – we do a live draft, so it's not – you know, there's no system saying you have to pick a kicker now or you have to pick a defense. I don't require any positions, you know, you can – so I never draft a kicker or a defense in my home leagues. And I always have a couple of extra position players through training camp, which, you know, we draft in week three of – gosh, it's weird now. Is there only 3 weeks now? I don't know. But we always draft the week before Labor Day, so we have 2 weeks until the season starts. So I'd rather carry an extra position player, and it might be that Gio or somebody like that is on there in case something happens. You know, sure. You get into a situation where one of these running backs gets hurt, and now he's not just a pass catcher. Now he's getting 6, 8, 10 carries and, you know, maybe five targets a game. Then it's something that we're talking about.
Hey, so Fantasy Alarm, you've been there a long time?
Yeah. I started with Alarm in 2010, actually.
Tell us what that's about. Like, what is the Fantasy Alarm?
I'm not allowed to. I can tell you, but I'd have to kill you. We don't house leagues at all. It's strictly a content site, nice. Data-driven tools, stuff like that. Our subscribers get, you know, all the content, the analysis, the DFS work. Everything like that. So it's a great team, solid group. Our Discord channel is locked in, so people can reach, you know, analysts with questions and chat and stuff like that, you know, throughout, you know, the day and into most of the nights and stuff. And we're writers, we're content providers, but, you know, I mean, we do a lot of other stuff, you know, that's behind the scenes. We do a lot of work for other companies, other websites. They contract us out for, you know, maybe it's our tech or maybe it's our, you know, our content team writing at some other places and things like that. So,
yeah, I mean, you guys got like all kinds of stuff on here, man. The betting, the DFS.
Well, yeah, we split up. We basically took Fantasy Alarm and then we kind of we divided it, you know, because we just had so much going on there that we divided it up to Fantasy Alarm, DFS Alarm, and then Wager Alarm.
Nice.
And that way, you know, for whatever need you have, there's like easy links to go back and forth between the sites, you know, because we were, you know, you get these like fantastically written article for seasonal, but it comes out on Thursday morning And by Thursday afternoon, it's completely buried because all the DFS stuff came out, you know, on top of it. So, you know, in order to kind of house everything properly and give make it easier for subscribers to find all the content, we just kind of divide. We branched out into the three sites and have it set that way.
Hey, look, before we get out of here, Larry, I got some trades, including a listener league trade that happened while we were on the air here.
Oh, so all right, man.
We're in the Dynasty Trades HQ Listener League, the OG HQ1, Howard. And so that's how Larry and I met. We had a Run DFF tank tracker last year because I was trying to suck, and it didn't start so good. I started out 2-0. I was like, what the fuck is going on here? Why am I winning games? And it was because of Patrick Mahomes and Kyler Murray. But all right, so Larry, I traded this is 16-team Superflex, a slight tight end premium.
Oh, and this is a big one, man.
Yeah. I was finally able to move my beloved Trevor Lawrence share there. So Trevor Lawrence and O.J. Howard for Davante Adams, Brandon Cooks, and a 2022 first.
Presumably an early one.
It's looking like it's probably going to be a
top 10.
Middle-ish.
Yeah.
Six to nine, something like that.
It's a no-brainer move for me. I mean, who are your quarterbacks?
Patrick Mahomes and Kyler Murray.
So what the hell do you need Trevor Lawrence for?
Right. My thought was, and Howard, I have five firsts next year now. And I'm trying to compete this year. I want to make moves to compete. So Christian McCaffrey is on that team. Now I have Davante Adams. Brandon Cooks is a nice, you know, second or third receiver. I've got Kareem Hunt and Miles Sanders. So it was one of those where I needed to get more pieces to start. It's a start 11 in a 16-team.
Yeah. He almost has enough players.
Dead weight. You shed the dead weight in O.J. Howard, too.
Right. Yeah, I don't care about O.J. Howard.
I like that side, too. I felt like you could have even potentially squeezed, you know, something else out of him because it is Trevor Lawrence, you know, and Davante Adams. This was when there was a little bit of uncertainty around.
Right. This was just 4 days ago.
Yeah.
So there was the whole Davante Adams tweeting about – or the stuff about him not – their contract extension is not going forward. And, you know, Aaron Rodgers is not going to report he's going to retire, yada, yada, yada. So there was something with that.
But so you got three players for one, basically. I mean, O.J. Howard is just
– right. I don't care about O.J. Howard.
Definition of a throw-in. Yeah. But so three players for one, and you need that depth. You need those players in a start 11, 16-teamer. You need legit starters, and you almost have a legit starting squad.
All right, so I made another trade. It was a 12 team. Well, it's a four copy league, but it's essentially 12 teams, 48 teams.
Is this the Dynasty Diagnostic Champions League?
That is correct.
Oh yeah, baby, we are in the rookie draft right now.
Yeah, and the slowest rookie draft of all time.
Yeah.
Holy shit!
Pick number 106.
Yeah.
310 is the 106th pick because there's four guys.
We're only like 2.5 weeks into this bitch. Yeah. So it's killing me. And I don't have any picks after the second round. So now I'm just like, I don't care. But I traded Noah Fant, Royce Freeman, and a third round pick. It's the 1.75 premium for Amari Cooper.
So Noah Fant for Amari Cooper.
Basically. Yeah. I can give a crap about the other pieces. Yep.
As long as Cooper's foot is healthy, I mean, you know, again, I hate the quarterback situation in Denver as is. So, yeah. I mean,
that's what terrifies me. I feel like if I want to go buy him from another copy, I'll get him for cheaper in season.
Yeah. Everyone's been again, shitting on have another lately. Also,
yeah, right. He's one of those acquirable tight ends for me.
Maybe I should try to snatch him up, man. I love those tight ends in a 1.75.
Yeah, and I'm also deep at tight end. I got Darren Waller, Gesicki, you know, a bunch of other pieces. It's a start three wide receiver league, I believe.
Nice. How many leagues you in, Howard?
I don't count until until week one starts.
Okay, Howard, I clarify this with how many lineup setting leagues are you in?
Yeah.
Because best ball doesn't count. Because
best ball does not count. No, last year I was in 22 lineup leagues.
Yeah,
lineup setting leagues, 22, and I probably had about 30 to 40 best balls.
Yeah,
that I did. You know, I always say that I want to pare down a little bit. You know, but I mean, I'll probably end up somewhere in like the 15 league range again, not counting the best ball.
Are you a Oh, what was I going to say? League setting leagues. Oh, yeah. So do you have what goes on? What's your Sunday football morning like? Because you're on the West Coast, so it starts a little earlier for you.
Yeah, 10 a.m. is game
time. You got any like work stuff that you got to deal with? Or like,
yeah,
anything in the way of your setting lineups?
No, I'm up at 4 a.m. and I am I'm putting together, you know, lineups, you know, example lineups on the site. I'm checking all the news. I'm making any final notes for like the playbook or the dartboard or, you know, anything like that. Then I'm looking at my teams. I'm trying to set through their lineup there. Then at 8 a.m., there's always a live stream that I'm on that I do for about an hour. So 8 a.m. my time till
11 Eastern, folks.
Yeah. So 11 Eastern and then, you know, till noon Eastern. And then that gives me an hour for any last minute shit that I
got
to do.
So you got the whole last hour, the important hour.
No, but there's a lot of distractions in that last hour too. I mean, do you run to the bathroom and do the lineup? Like,
I just I strap on a diaper at 4 a.m. and I just piss some shit all over myself while I'm sitting there doing it. I mean, yeah, that last hour, that last hour is just to kind of just decompress and make sure that my lineups are set. But the problem is that I'm always, doing stuff for work up until noon. Yeah. So like when shit happens and somebody like makes a last minute pickup or something like that, like those guys, I end up missing out on those guys who suddenly become available and like on the Sunday morning, like before anything else happens.
Yep. Nice.
Yeah. All right, Larry, one more trade. Listener League. Oh. It happened while we were on the air.
Dynasty Hot Sauce Listener League.
Right.
This is
let's crush one side or the other. Let's do it. Oh. All right. So we have Ruben trading Josh Jacobs to Jake for Chris Carson and what Jake assumes is a late 2022 second.
Okay.
Josh Jacobs or Chris Carson and a second, random second, in my opinion, 2022.
I'm not a Carson guy. Josh Jacobs, all the way.
I mean, I prefer Jacobs over Carson just as a player. I don't like the situation with them bringing in Kenyon Drake. And to be perfectly honest, I wish I liked anything in this world as much as Pete Carroll likes Chris Carson. So,
Here's what I told, and this happened, and I was, distracted a little bit, but Jake was asking, how do people feel about Josh Jacobs? And I said, I feel the same way about him this year that I did last year. They had 457 carries last year out of the backfield. Like, okay, so what's Kenyon Drake going to snatch 150 of those? There's plenty of volume to go around.
Sure.
He was RB8 last year, Josh Jacobs was, in a season where he's not catching a bunch of balls. Whatever. He's going to be somewhere in that low-end RB1 range. Why am I scared of him? Like, why is anybody scared of him? If you look at the volume the team has, he doesn't need to get 80% of the volume to be the same dude he's been. And you gain a couple years. You don't have Chris Carson's old ass out there.
Dude, Chris Carson's going to be 27.
Yeah. Yeah, a sixth-rounder, 27.
Three, so, right? He fumbles like a 40-year-old.
Yeah, that's Josh Jacobs all the way, no brainer.
Yeah, I think giving up, how we feel about lates, about seconds, especially if we assume they're going to be late. So, whatever.
All right.
Well done, Jake, and you're a dumbass, Ruben.
Yeah, man. What were you thinking, bitch? Now trade me Zach Wilson, Ruben, in the other league we're together.
You let Ruben get Zach Wilson?
Yes.
Oh, you ain't getting him for anything more than like it's going to cost you like three firsts to get Zach Wilson.
The Wilson jersey, I've already been skimming my Chinese website that I can get a jersey for $23.
Where can you get the discount fat head? Yeah, I think we've done well, and I'm just about done with this beer. So,
all right, man, let's do this, baby. All right, so we have at RotoBuzzGuy on Twitter, Howard Bender, Fantasy Alarm, Serious Fantasy. XM Radio, New York Post writer. Dang it.
Well, all these really big titles that Larry's not used to dealing with.
It's like a fucking tongue twister at this point.
Right? But you know what? Like, and my home smells of rich mahogany, and I have many leather-bound books, too.
I mean, you're rattling off. I mean, I could just keep going on and on. Like you got the YouTube special on Fridays, the Get Buzzed, right? YouTube. Yep. I subscribe to that. What else? You got something?
The Annie Up podcast. Also.
Yep, with Adam Ronis. Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Nice, baby. All right. Let's do this. Are you ready? Let's rock this party out, bitches. Thanks for listening to the Dynasty Hot Sauce Podcast.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Barry Monkey and Justin Rogers talking Dynasty football, baby.